name is Krishnan Srinivasan, and I'm a spare tar that's been brought in at the 11th hour, 59th minute, to stand in for Professor Mayo. So I'll do the best I can with the limited resources I have. I don't know whether you need any introduction to the panelists, but I think that probably you have that in the program already, so we'll skip that part. The idea is that each of the distinguished panelists will speak for 10 or 12 minutes as they wish, and after that we'll give plenty of time for questions from the floor, because I think there should be more involvement from the audience. You've taken the trouble to come, so you deserve every opportunity to ask difficult questions. So as far as the subject matter is concerned, I'll proceed to give you some random thoughts. Values, principles, interests, objectives. Although these words are very commonly casually conflated to mean the same thing, obviously there's a big difference between each of these various words. All countries may claim to have principles in foreign affairs. Of course, all of them do. No country will say it doesn't have principles. But they usually mean strategies or interests. But principles, to my mind, are something else. They are deep-seated values, usually inherited through long cultural, societal, religious traditions, or occasionally through landmark historical events, unique to that specific nation. Rarely, an individual sometimes, through his or her charisma, example, or doctrine, might contribute an obligation or a sense of values to policy. But these are rare instances. By these criteria, not many countries could be said to base their foreign policy on principle-based or value system. Almost none would be able to assert that their policies have lived up to that code of ethics. Nations that profess to be anchored to an ethical foreign policy, for example, as was specifically enunciated by Foreign Secretary Robin Cook, which is a name some of you may remember, at the start of the first Labour government in 1995, under Tony Blair in the United Kingdom, that government found to their chagrin that within a few short months, such claims of having an ethical foreign policy were demolished in the face of harsh reality of interstate relations. In fact, in that case, it was the harsh reality of arms sales to Saudi Arabia, which was strenuously opposed by many sections of the British public, and curiously enough, right now, probably even today, the British public is divided on exactly the same question: arms sales to Saudi Arabia during the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia's visit to the UK. So, national interest is often put forward as a rationale for pursuing a particular line of policy. Interest is a totally fungible term. The national interest is not found on some little piece of paper locked away in a cupboard in the local foreign ministry. Values and principles in foreign policy are professed, espoused, and promoted in the main by Western countries. These are products of political revolutions rather than religious or cultural traditions. Thus we have the British Glorious Revolution, 1688, the American Revolution, the French Revolution, and the Russian Revolution, all of which were originally specific to the country of origin, but were later sought to be exported in the context of values, eternal and uncontested, universal, if you like, in an often expeditionary manner to the rest of the world. The victors of the First World War and in particular American President Woodrow Wilson, sought to endow world affairs with a moral code. After the Second World War, Western leaders, who included a gentleman called Jan Smuts, who was a leading figure of apartheid in South Africa, took matters a bit further by casting the Declaration of Human Rights in the context of their principles and describing it as universal. Despite the racial discrimination that then prevailed in the United States and Southern Africa and the colonial empires then controlled by several European states, colonialism was obviously the antithesis of ethics, values, and human rights. The values professed by the Western Bloc are, in summary, those of democracy, liberalism, and human rights. That can be expanded with several other adjectives and nouns. Originally, these were deployed as a part of the West's campaign to oppose the Soviet Union and communism. Values are an overarching and legitimizing pillar of the West's external relations, highlighting the dimension of eschewing the politics of self-interest and realist power politics. The West considers that its values should be observed and emulated by other nations in order to make the world safer and more peaceful. Contemporary international law is predominantly a creation of West Europe and the United States, and these two have a strong interest in maintaining and strengthening it. The real divergence comes between them and South and East Asia. The relevance of shared principles shrinks when big Asian countries are not inclined to provide support to the West to protect its civilizing global order. Europeans first, and then Americans, had mastery over power, principles, concepts, and values for many centuries. In the future new world, whether it's an Asian century or not, the inherited assumptions of West and East may have no purchase. The Western narrative, in which its values enrich the rest of the world, may conceal a complex truth. The truth is that it may not be as easy to set the world agenda in future as it was 73 years ago. So we shall have to wait and see. But we don't have to wait long for the next speaker on the panel. It's Mr. Fredrik Eriksson. He's the founder and the director of a think tank in Brussels, which is recognized as one of the leading think tanks, and he is one of the leading thinkers of the European Union. Fredrik Eriksson.
Thank you very much, Krishna, and also thank you very much to Ikre for hosting this panel tonight and inviting me to join it. I'm impressed to see so many people in the room, bearing in mind it starts at 7 o'clock on a Friday evening. If I was going to host a seminar like this in Brussels, there would be no person in the room. So I am going to share with you a few thoughts I have around the issues that Krishna laid out. And I'm going to talk about Europe and what I see happening in Europe right now. It is, as many of you will know and perhaps have experienced in practice as well, when you've been dealing with the European Union, that it is a political entity that claims a very strong moral superiority, that it quite often classifies itself of being almost a moral superpower. And that morality can be defined in different ways. It's a political entity that will consistently raise issues about human rights violations when it deals with other countries in the world. It will raise issues about environmental protection, natural conservation. It will raise issues about labor standards, workers' rights, and a host of different things that sometimes actually may be against its own economic interests. One of the big political projects that I've seen in Europe over the past 10 plus years is, of course, the attempt to decarbonize the economy and to move away from different type of energy sources and different technologies that emit a lot of carbon. And one of the striking things with this entire program is that so many governments and people in Europe, citizens in Europe, have been ready to accept without sort of any big political protest the costs that have been associated with it. Even if you can agree with the objective of decarbonizing your economy, there's no question that this has been extraordinarily expensive in European economies, and it's been even more expensive if you try to combine it with the closure of nuclear plants, which happened in Germany with the big energy vending after the Fukushima catastrophe. It's obviously, it's known to anyone who studied these issues that it's been eating up a lot of potential for economic growth and for improvement of the economy. As part of that, EU has been also very insistent vis-a-vis other countries to commit to international protocols on reducing carbon emissions, or at least reducing the growth of carbon emissions in some parts of the world. So on the one hand, we have experiences like that. On the other hand, we also have a completely different development, which can lead a lot of people to speak about a European type of hypocrisy. Krishnan mentioned initially the experience of Robin Cook when he was the foreign minister and had to sell arms to Saudi Arabia. There was a pretty recent experience of that when Sweden had a new government about 2.5 years ago. It prided itself of being the first government that had a feminist foreign policy, and it claimed to put a lot of emphasis on defending women's rights when it organized its international affairs. And one of the consequences of that was, of course, that it was difficult to deal with Saudi Arabia because of the status of women's rights. And that policy worked for about a week until it dawned on people that Saudi Arabia actually buy weapons from Sweden and buy a lot of technology from a company called Ericsson that are used for military purposes. And even if remains the case that the Swedish government will call, or at least will say that it has a feminist foreign policy, it has downplayed that particular element of its foreign policy substantially in order to gain contracts and to sell products abroad. And this is true for many other countries as well. We saw until a decade ago how many European leaders, when they were going to China, was preaching human rights, was defending the Dalai Lama, and were almost willingly accepting the fact that this defense and this promotion of different ideas would come at a cost, and that cost would be small orders for new products from these countries. When these leaders go to China today, they don't even mention these things. They say that they may bring things up in private, but as most people would suspect, those conversations are going to be very short and probably going to involve handing over a document that the President Xi can read at some time, or at a point when he has some time, about what this country thinks about human rights violations. So we have seen this development, and of course it has accelerated after the financial crisis in Europe from 2007 to 2008 and forwards, when urgency in raising our export and selling more to other countries increased quite substantially. And even if there is a balance between idealism and economic interest in the pursuit of our policy in Europe, I think it's fair to say that because of the crisis, Europe has been erring more on the side of defending economic interest in the recent past rather than trying to pursue a particular vision of the world that it wants others to follow. So that would be my first observation, partly related to that, and partly related to what's happened in the past decade or so with the crisis, not just the economic crisis, but also with the refugee situation that many countries in Europe were confronted with, especially in 2015, when the number of refugees that arrived to Europe was extraordinarily high. But of course, that was just the peak of a development that had been going on for several years. And this is a development, and what I want to talk about now is something which I think is pretty fundamental, and I think is going to have lasting effects on Europe, the European Union, and the way that you and the rest of the world will perceive the European Union in the future. For sort of the past at least 30 years, I mean, starting from the Cold War, there has been, I'd say, ideologically and in the perception about the future in most government offices around Europe, there has been this idea that even if the road forward will be a bit difficult, inevitably it's going towards what the Rome Treaty in the EU calls an ever closer union, towards more power being distributed to Brussels, to more federalism, and to greater ability of existing institutions in Brussels, the European Union institutions, to handle issues both domestically and in Europe's foreign relations. As part of that, we have seen those stronger statements about Europe being a moral superpower. Almost a civilizational state in the sense that it wants to promote a specific idea of civilization to the rest of the world. Some have talked about regulatory imperialism in the sense that many countries have felt that Europe has been sort of pushing down its own idea of regulation on other countries, and if other countries hadn't accepted that, they would have seen much less market access in Europe for their own exports, so there had been a price to pay from not following Europe's particular idea of regulation. We still see that. For instance, now we have a big debate about data privacy, data integrity, and Europe has taken a very strong stance on those issues. It is now in the process of implementing a policy, an acronym that surprisingly many people in the world have heard about, which is called GDPR, which stands for Global Data Protection Regulation. What is interesting with that particular regulation is that in order for other countries to basically get an easy form of access when it comes to cross-border data flows, it isn't enough just to have an equivalent standard like the one in the EU. These countries must basically sign up and introduce in their own books a regulation which is practically identical to what exists in the European Union. Quite often we have dealt with these matters on the principle of equivalence, which is that we're trying to figure out whether the standard in another country is similar to the standard which is applied in Europe, and if it is, well, then it's good enough. So we're trying to find a way to avoid introducing different sort of barriers between that, but now we're moving towards this form of regulatory imperialism where we demand identical type of regulations that should be introduced on the books of other countries. So you would have seen sort of this development with an ever closer union, with more power being handed to these institutions. But if you look at it from the European angle and see this particular development of what has happened, I think it's correct to describe this development as if Europe has been moving towards what can be called a postmodern state. And a postmodern state is something which in Europe, of course, derives from the particular history of Europe that we basically in 1945 started from year zero after two recent world wars in order to build peace, stability, and economic development in a region which had been plagued by conflict and wars. And as a consequence of that, we pretty quickly moved towards one of the core principles of our post-modern state, which is that you downplay the significance of territory. Territoriality is basically not an issue. In fact, you belong to the rival camp, which is that you want to take away the significance of borders. It's not just that you try to downplay the significance, you want to eradicate borders by principle, because borders themselves represent the demarcation line between countries, and it's those demarcation lines that countries have been fighting over. But as part of that was also the notion that you can create state institutions in Brussels without having a clear demos, without having a clear idea of people and those that should be and those that these institutions should represent. Europe may now be moving to sort of an Indo-Franca situation, in the sense that most people speak English. Not all do, but most people will have at least a basic understanding of English. But that is actually a pretty new phenomenon. And we have operated so far on the principle that we can have this demos without having a language to champion each other, to have debates, and to have significant confrontation between different political ideas about what these institutions should do. In fact, we try to take away that idea to have a political combat of what these institutions should do. We, after a while, formed an assembly called the European Parliament, but this is not a parliament that controls power, political power. It's a parliament which remains, in the words of a former president of this parliament, a Mickey Mouse parliament, in the sense that it's not a real parliament. It's rather a parliament which sees its roles as being part of the execution of power and sees its broader ideological role as being the vector for driving more power to itself, for driving more power to European Union institutions. It follows on all these observations that there is no common idea what constitutes a national interest. What is it that these institutions are going to defend vis-a-vis other countries? And that can be in military terms, but it can also be in economic terms. What type of interest is it that these institutions should try to work for when they deal with other parts of the world? I think it's fair to say that this remains a rather powerful idea in some quarters in Europe of the ever closer union, driving towards a much more clear postmodern state where you have more power but less democratic control of institutions in Brussels. Someone like Emmanuel Macron, the new president of France, is clearly someone who is entertaining ideas and reforms going in that direction. I think there are limits to how far he's willing to go, but he's clearly on the side of the arguments of Eurofederalism and someone who wants to go much further. You will still find a lot of politicians in Germany that are also ideologically convinced by this notion of a Eurofederalism and that we are going to move in this particular direction. However, the observation I really wanted to share with you is that I think developments over the past 10 years, perhaps even longer, have gradually eaten itself into the political personality of the EU and is now undermining that idea of the future of Europe at what I would say to a significant degree. What Europe is finding now is a resurging form of nationalism and a rediscovery of notions of national identity. We find a Europe which is occupied by migration and multiculturalism. There will, of course, be lots of variety. between different countries in Europe to the extent that they have received migrants from abroad and migrants that are culturally very different from native populations. But from the EU to several governments in Europe, there has been a fairly clear and consistent argument along multicultural lines over a pretty long time, which now is not being necessarily profoundly challenged, but it's at least the case that a lot of countries are trying to figure out that in this spirit of multiculturalism or in this spirit of European cooperation at all, what is it that constitutes our national identity and what role should that play in the future? We have fairly liberal versions of that, which we have seen pretty recently. One of them you will have heard a lot about, which is Brexit, the fact that the UK voted to leave the European Union. And I would describe the majority, or at least the consequence of the Brexit vote, the political interpretation of what it meant as a liberal form of nationalism, which is that Brits voted in favor to own their own demos, to have more sovereignty. They want to have more ability to articulate an idea about national identity. That identity itself is not an ethnic identity, but it's an identity which they are looking for and feel that they have to develop, but they are not doing it in a sort of populist authoritarian way, and they are not doing it at the same time as they're trying to pursue other forms of policies that we would call protectionist, authoritarian, or that in effect wants to pull up the drawbridge with the rest of the world. On the contrary, I would say that the main interpretation of the Brexit vote will be that UK is trying to discover or perhaps rediscover a different form of internationalism, how it's going to engage with other parts of the world, trade more with other parts of the world, and perhaps be less protective of its own market and market access than it's been as part of the EU. We can debate whether that is right or not, but I think this is hard to describe this development. We can also see influences of authoritarian or populist versions of nationalism in Europe as well. One we saw last weekend during the election in Italy, where the clear winners from that election is firstly a populist party called Movement 5 Stelle, which is a party who wants, in principle, to abolish the parliament and have independent votes on matters of political affairs in Italy. The second winner was Lega Nord, who is a party with post-fascist roots, who has a very strong notion about Italian identity and are very much against, especially migration and the way that the Italian identity has changed. There is a fascist party that also gained pretty much in the election called Brothers of Italy. And together, these three parties form a pretty solid majority in both the Senate and the House in Italy these days. They are probably too distant from each other culturally and intellectually in order to form their own governments, but a very, very strong protest votes from Italian voters against establishment, against political parties in the center, and as part of that, also against the European Union. This was a vote which was more about trying to recover some of the power of Italian politics, which for several decades have moved towards Brussels. It's always been, for a long time, been the philosophy of lots of governments in Italy that the best way to try to civilize Italy is to send more power to Brussels and Europeanize Italy, because that's the way we can control the sort of lower instincts that we can find in Italy. But I think it's fair to describe the reaction now as being a protested against long-term development going in that direction. We have Poland and Hungary, where we see also developments that are not exactly similar, but they're not exactly different either, where there is recurring examples of violations of rule of law, where media polarity, control over judges, etc., are part of daily politics in these countries these days. And in both Poland and Hungary, it is very much about a long-time process of reconnecting their societies and societies which have changed extraordinarily over the past 20 years with what these societies were in the past. There's a lot of political nostalgia in these societies about sort of what sort of the true Hungary, what the true Poland really is. We see a country like Spain having problems as well with regional separatism, which is creating a stronger instinct in Madrid to become even more nationalistic than they've been in the past, and sort of with lots of points about history, reinterpreting history about the role of Catalonia, the role of Madrid, etc., which became pretty difficult last autumn when Catalonia decided to hold a plebiscite, a referendum on separation from Spain, but it was an unconstitutional referendum, and it consequently led to that the Prime Minister of Catalonia had to flee to Belgium, and he was thinking about seeking political refuge there in order not to be taken by the Spanish police. So I think, and as I said, I mean, I think this development is pretty fundamental, and I think it's about to have lasting changes in Europe. Exactly what changes it will lead to, we'll have to see. But this sort of trend we're seeing with both liberal versions of nationalism and more populist or authoritarian versions of nationalism are pretty fundamentally going against sort of this 30 years, perhaps even longer, idea of Europe, of the ever closer union, the postmodern state, and the notion that you can actually build sustainable political solutions without the demos and without the ability to formulate an idea about your own national interests. I think this is also going to change the authority of the institutions of the EU, like the European Commission, the authorities that the government of India is going to deal with. I think for other countries, it's probably an EU which is going to become easier to understand. Concept of states, authority, interest will become clearer, I think. But it's also going to be a Europe which is far more difficult to deal with. If you sit, for instance, here in New Delhi and you want to do trade agreements or have environmental cooperation or foreign policy cooperation with an entity like the EU. An EU which is split is always a far more difficult project than an EU which is more in unity. Because an EU which is split is going to be entirely consumed by finding peace stability in Europe and finding compromises and diplomatic solutions to the differences that exist. That's the type of Europe which is going to become introvert, navel-gazing, more occupied by its own problems than having an appetite for dealing with the rest of the world. So there's going to be change ahead. I'm not exactly sure what that change will look like, but we need to prepare for the worst.
Thank you very much, Frederick Eriksson. I'd like now to ask Tadas Giannoussan. He is a professor at Sofia University in Japan, and he will now speak to us.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much. I would like to thank ICREAL for organizing this event, and for I would
like to thank Tether Trust for the generous financial support. It is highly appreciated, and it's a great pleasure and honor for me to be here.
I'm not sure if my remarks really fit the bill here. Ideally speaking, I should be speaking about the reflecting on the sort of panel's theme from a Japanese perspective, but the theme of the panel is pretty general, so I took the liberty of interpreting it in my own way, and came up with this set of remarks, which may or may not be in dialogue with the general theme of this panel. So my remarks are entitled Principles and Practice in International Relations, Japan's Security Policy from Parochialism to Universalism, the Debate on Article 9 of the Constitution and on Collective Self-Defense. This is a very Japan-specific kind of theme, and if you find that this my remarks are not in dialogue with the rest of the panel, then you can see this as a sort of an instance of Japanese parochialism in action or something like that. And since this is a Friday evening, I wanted to start with a kind of a lighter note. Oops. Well, I'm showing you a segment of a movie that was released originally in 1973. It's called Japan Sinks. This should be enough. I mean, as you know, Japan is a country that is prone to earthquakes, and fear that the next big one might hit again, and the next time it might hit not the sort of relatively sparsely populated areas of Northeast Japan, but rather major urban centers like Tokyo and Osaka, is a fear that is constantly on the mind of the Japanese people. And this movie, originally released in 1973, captures that fear very well. And what is really interesting about the movie is that even though the premise of the movie is that due to huge shifts in the Earth's crust, you know, almost the entire Japanese archipelago is submerged under the sea within a span of a single year, right? What is going to happen? And what is interesting for me about this movie is that even though most of the Japanese archipelago is going to be submerged underwater, the disaster does not seem to affect our neighboring countries like Russia or South Korea or Taiwan. You know, so it's a natural disaster of humongous proportions, but somehow the damages are strictly limited within Japanese national boundaries. And so, you know, I sometimes in my course on Japanese security policy, I talk about this movie and tell my students, hey, you know, Japan has a territorial dispute with a number of neighboring countries, and you know, if the Japanese archipelago ever goes down under the sea, and if those disputed islands goes down with the rest of the Japanese archipelago, then we will know for sure that those disputed territories were actually Japanese territories, and the neighboring countries will recognize them as Japanese territories, thereby solving the territorial dispute, you know. I tell you this story because I wanted to bring to your attention the kind of parochialism which I see as a kind of characteristic of a Japanese intellectual kind of tradition. And next slide. The oldest extant history book in Japan, the Kojiki, and this is also a kind of a classic text in Shintoism also, was compiled in 712 AD, starts with a creation myth. But interestingly, this Japanese creation myth talks about the creation only of the Japanese archipelago, minus Okinawa and Hokkaido, and it doesn't tell us anything about how this Korean Peninsula came about and how the Chinese continent came about, much less about the rest of the world. Right? And this, I think, is symptomatic of the kind of parochialism that I'm talking about, that is characteristic in Japanese intellectual tradition. Japan, historically, is a kind of a country that has grown up on the periphery of a great civilization, that is China. And educated Japanese throughout the centuries have been used to kind of looking at the rest of the world through intellectual prisms imported from these advanced and larger civilizations, that is China and also India, you know, through Buddhism. In the modern period, of course, Japan has predominantly looked at the world through intellectual prisms imported from the West and to some extent from the Soviet Union. for communists. And because of this tendency to view, so there is a tendency to view the rest of the world through intellectual prisms imported from larger and more advanced civilizations. But when it comes to sort of understanding Japan itself, Japanese intellectuals have typically not been very satisfied with using those imported intellectual prisms. Therefore, the Japanese had a tendency to sort of develop an alternative and separate intellectual prism, which is valid only for understanding Japan. And the sort of the story I told you about the Kojiki creation myth is an example of this tendency. And we can find other similar instances. For example, in Japan, you know, the teaching of history is strictly separated into the teaching of Japanese history and world history. And in teaching world history, in Japanese history, the consciousness that Japan, Japanese history is also part of world history is kind of absent. You know, this is kind of facilitated by the insular condition, geographical condition, condition of our country, but it is a characteristic of Japanese parochialism. And how does this have, what does this have to do with a security policy, you might be asking? Well, I think that, you know, this kind of parochialism has also influenced Japan's understanding of, you know, security issues. And Japan, being an island country, has no experience of foreign rule on historical record prior to 1945. And as a result of which, the same old, the same dynasty has continued to exist at least since the 6th century onward. So it's the longest, you know, like a continuous dynasty that has reigned over Japan over the centuries. And this fact has been become the source of a myth of Japan as a kind of a special country enjoying divine protection. And this idea became the sort of official ideology of the Japanese state from the late 19th century to the Second World War. Of course, you know, the after the end of the Second World War, this influence of this kind of mythology was sort of declined, of course, and the under American occupation, a new constitution was introduced which emphasized the themes of universalism. And if you look at the preamble of the constitution, it talks about democracy is a universal principle of mankind, and also laws of political morality are universal. So the Japanese kind of political discourse on domestic and foreign policy issues have, you know, tilted in the direction of universalism to a greater extent. But this does not mean that the parochialism, traditional parochialism, has disappeared from a Japanese sort of intellectual tradition. And one example would be the development of the sort of post-war Japanese pacifism. At least some strands of post-war Japanese pacifism can be looked at as an instance of this kind of intellectual parochialism. Because, you know, like Article 9 of the sort of Japanese Constitution, ben, you know, prohibits Japan from sort of use or resort to use of force or threat of force, and or to sort of resort to war as a means of national policy or something, and also bans the possession of what is called war potential. But as you all know, you know, the initial Japanese kind of ideal, initial constitutional ideal, this was, by the way, eagerly embraced by a large majority of the Japanese people who were very tired of the Second World War, and also, you know, there was a lot of anti-military sentiment growing in during the wartime period, and because of that, even though the constitution was imposed by the Americans, it was eagerly embraced by a majority of the Japanese people. But unfortunately, the reality of international politics in the post-Second World War period did not live up to this beautiful ideal, and as a result, the Americans changed their policy toward Japan in the direction of building Japan up as an anti-communist bastion, and correspondingly, the Japanese government moved in the direction of establishing the self-defense forces and allowing the United States troops to be stationed for the long term on Japanese territories. And so, unfortunately for the Japanese idealist pacifists, you know, the Article 9 of the Constitution has never existed, not a single day, without the existence of some form of military institution in Japan, plus the presence of U.S. Forces in Japan. So, I mean, from a subjective viewpoint, the Japanese pacifists in the post-war period felt that Japan was a special nation conducting a lofty experiment and from a kind of a moral high ground, you know, even though Japan was an aggressor in Second World War, because it has been defeated totally and it has been bombed by nuclear weapons, somehow it has acquired this moral status of victimhood or something, and you know, it has become a missionary for the world peace or something. And that perhaps was certainly better than, you know, being an aggressive, externally aggressive Japan. It was certainly an improvement, but the reality of it was still a kind of a, there was a gap between the reality of international politics and what was being discussed among Japanese pacifists. And in that sense, I think that, you know, this post-war Japanese pacifism has to be characterized also as a sort of a example of intellectual parochialism that is characteristic of Japan. And in recent years, as many of you know, Japan's security policies have been changing directions. There are many aspects of this change, but the one is the kind of strengthening of security cooperation not only with the United States, but also with a number of other friendly countries, including Australia, India, South Korea, United Kingdom, France, Philippines, even Vietnam. But another sort of aspect of change in Japanese security policy has been the strengthening of the legal foundation for Japan's security policy by, one, reinterpreting Article 9 of the Constitution, which has been done, and two, introducing a package of legislations which are collectively known as peace and security legislations. Critics call them war legislations or something. Third, possibly by revising the Constitution itself, and this is still being debated, right? And this is a basic timeline of what happened with regard to reinterpretation of Article 9 of the Constitution and the subsequent introduction of the so-called peace and security legislation. You know, in December of 2012, Abe returned as a prime minister. The next summer, LDP won the upper house elections and was in a stronger political position. By May of 2014, the commission appointed by Abe submitted a report recommending reinterpretation of Article 9 of the Constitution. And in July of that year, the cabinet made a decision to reinterpret Article 9 for the purpose of the Japanese government. And in December of that year, LDP wins lower house elections, so the electorate didn't express a clear no to the Abe's reinterpretation. And by summer of 2015, the peace and security legislation passes the National Diet. March next year, it goes into effect, etc. This is the basic timeline. So it's been 2 years since the introduction of PSL went into effect. But this has been very controversial inside Japan. I mean, you know, this is when this is the sort of a newspaper reporting the sort of passing of the PSL through the National Diet. But this was surrounded by a large scale, you know, by Japanese standard demonstrations surrounding the National Diet. You know, like the placards say that well, we will not let them fight a war. You know, And one of the key points in the sort of reinterpretation of the Article 9 of the Constitution was that before the sort of reinterpretation, individual self-defense was okay, you know, within a limited extent, and collective self-defense was a no-no for the Japanese state. But after the reinterpretation, the reinterpretation allowed the Japanese government to exercise the right of collective self-defense on some limited occasions. This is the change. But this has been very controversial, and many people characterize it as a step in the wrong direction. It is a sort of, you know, a very dangerous for the administration to change the interpretation of the Constitution at will and then introduce a new set of legislation. So some people see, oh, Japan was a beautiful country of cherry blossoms, but peace and Constitution. The Constitution is going, Japan is turning black. Victoria representation of how some people see this change. But I think, you know, like, this is a spurious argument, I think, because of the innate parochialism in the debate surrounding security issues in Japan, I think the Japanese government has come to define the concept of collective self-defense in a very sort of distinctive way, and that has led to this complications regarding interpretation of Article 9, and I would like to explain what I'm trying to say. And this is the Japanese government definition of the right of collective self-defense. The Japanese government says that the right of collective self-defense is the right of a state to use force to stop an armed attack on a foreign country with which the state has close relations, even if the state itself is not under direct attack. For example, you know, okay, if somebody used forces to attack, let's say, South Korea, with which Japan has close relations and close security relations, Japan may use force to help South Korea defend itself, even though Japan has not been attacked by the third country that has attacked South Korea. Now, this is the Japanese government's definition of the right of collective self-defense, and some of you may be thinking, some of you may think that this is a strange definition, some other people may think that this is a, what's wrong with this definition. But one thing that we need to note about this definition is that, you know, this, according to this definition, the right of collective self-defense belongs to the country that helps other countries defend themselves, and not to the country which receives help. In other words, collective self-defense right is interpreted as a country, the right to sort of, you know, like interfere in somebody else's conflict and help the country under attack. And from this interpretation, it would follow that collective self-defense is not really self-defense, but it's a sort of right to defend some others. You know, it's a collective other defense, not collective self-defense. You know, so this kind of interpretation gives people the impression that the right to collective self-defense is the right to pick somebody else's fight. And of course, that's going to get you into trouble, which, convinces many Japanese people to that the collective self-defense right is a very dangerous thing to embrace. But this is not how, you know, the UN Charter sees this collective right of collective self-defense. Article 51 of the UN Charter says that state A can help defend another country C if country C is attacked by a third country, B. There are two conditions attached to this in the UN Charter. One is that C and A must report this incident to the UN Security Council. And secondly, C and A can exercise the right of self-defense, collective self-defense, only until the UN Security Council takes care of the problem. You know, these are the conditions attached to collective self-defense right in the UN Charter. So what exactly is the right of collective self-defense? It should be interpreted as the right of states to get together with other states and to defend themselves collectively. Now, this is the, you know, how the right of collective self-defense should be interpreted according to the Article 51 of the UN Charter. In other words, collective self-defense right is not the right to pick up somebody else's fight, but the right of a group of states to defend themselves as a group. You know, and so what's the difference? The right of collective self-defense, according to the Japanese government, is the right of the country that helps other countries to defend themselves. But according to the interpretation of Article 51 of the UN Charter, it is the right to defend, it is not, the right of collective self-defense does not only belong to the country that helps other countries defend themselves, but it also belongs to the country that receives from help from other countries. So evidences that this is the correct interpretation of collective right of collective self-defense. I mean, when you exercise the right of collective self-defense, you have to report it to the UN Security Council. And if you look at the 15 cases that, you know, the countries have reported about the right of collective self-defense, you know, to the UN Security Council, 11 cases have been reported not only from the sort of state that provided assistance, but from the country that received assistance. You know, these 11 countries received assistance from another state in defending themselves, reported it as exercise of, you know, self-defense right to the UN Security Council. And of these 11 cases, in five cases, the countries that received help from another country makes specific reference to the right of collective self-defense. In other words, in at least in those five cases, you know, these countries felt, okay, yes, okay. Another example would be the original U.S.-Japan Security Treaty of 1951, you know, which says that the Charter of the United Nations recognizes that all nations possess an inherent right of individual and collective self-defense. In exercise of these rights, Japan desires that the United States of America should maintain armed forces in and around Japan, which means that in 1951, the Japanese government thought that by allowing the U.S. to use military bases in Japan, Japan was exercising the right of collective self-defense. So this was different from the contemporary definition of the right of collective self-defense adopted by the Japanese government. So the question is, why did the Japanese government have the Japanese government come to adopt this distinctive definition? Well, I mean, the answer is that the Japanese government needed to convince the domestic public that, you know, even though Japan has self-defense force despite Article 9, there is a limit beyond which Japan will not go. And the distinction between individual and collective self-defense proved to be a very sort of convenient concept to draw on for the Japanese government bureaucrats to convince these sort of domestic audiences that, okay, we're allowing ourselves to do this individual self-defense, but not collective self-defense. But in drawing the line between individual self-defense and collective self-defense, basically the Japanese government sort of defined collective self-defense as sort of getting into somebody else's affairs, you know? I mean, individual self-defense, so in some ways this kind of, the way the line was drawn between collective self-defense and individual self-defense reflects the parochialist orientation in Japanese security policy, which says that as long as we are okay, you know, like we're just fine, you know, like we don't want to get into any trouble by picking our noses into somebody else's fight. So the general conclusion is that the crisis of constitutionalism that some critics in Japan talk about is a kind of spurious crisis born of parochialism imposed for Japan's attitude toward the outside world. And Japan is moving, although slowly, in a direction of playing a more active role in security issues, but this is happening mostly within the context of cooperation with like-minded states, which I think is somewhat close to what, a Japanese equivalent to sort of more liberal version of a national assertion. I mean, we could also see a more sort of a populist authoritarian national assertion of populist and authoritarian nationalism in Japan today, but as long as the Japan can keep cooperating with sort of friendly states in defending its basic security interests, I'm hopeful that a more liberal version of Japanese activism will prevail over the more populist and authoritarian version. Thank you. Sorry.
Thank you very much, Tadashi Anno-san. Can I now request Mr. Ravi Velur to say a few words? He is the associate editor of the famous Straits Times newspaper in Singapore.
Thank you, Foreign Secretary Srinivasan. Thanks everybody for sitting through this. It's very difficult to beat a Japanese professor who can show you movies. But I tried. I'm essentially a storyteller. I'm a newspaper man. I don't have a PhD. But let me tell you the situation of a small state like Singapore and the value or the importance of principles in conducting its foreign policy. Let me just outline to you Singapore's situation. We are the smallest country in Southeast Asia. A tiny island of 5.5 million people, one third of whom were born outside of Singapore or do not even belong there in terms of their nationality. We are a Chinese majority island. A little red dot is what one slightly hostile Indonesian president called us because we are Chinese, predominantly Chinese, in a green Malay Sea, in the sense that we have Malaysia to the north of us and huge Indonesia to the south, to the bottom of us. You could say we are very close to the United States in terms of our strategic outlook and our orientation. We don't even have sufficient water. We depend on Malaysia for a significant chunk of our water. Trade is three times the size of our GDP. And we exist off the world. We see ASEAN as a key pillar in our foreign policy. Our whole approach is for an open architecture in the region that is increasingly being called the Indo-Pacific. We don't take sides. Our essential foreign policy is to be friends with all who wants to be friends with us. At the same time, we're not a people who believe in being careless. We have one of the most powerful militaries in Southeast Asia, and that's what keeps us secure. And the fact that there's been no war is essentially because there is that guarantee, security guarantee. It's the number one item in our budget spending is defense, ahead of infrastructure. But at the same time, we never felt limited by our size or by our location. Our foreign policy vectors arise from these realities. So I'm going to talk about just one principle that is very important and sacred to Singapore, and that is the principle of the rule of law. And I'm going to talk to you from four stories that I'm going to tell you. The first dates back to the very birth of Singapore as an independent nation, and that was the time when Indonesia under Sukarno had started this policy of what they call confrontasi, which means confrontation in Southeast Asia. He was attacking, he didn't like the Federation of Malaysia that was set up. So he was sending guerrillas into these things. Singapore suffered bombings, a series of bombings. And seven people died and 33 people were, more than 50 were injured. In one particular case, McDonald House, three people died. And more than 30 were injured by these Indonesian Marines who were sent there. They were caught. And due process took place. They were sentenced to death. Meanwhile, the government had changed in Indonesia, and Suharto had taken power. And Suharto appealed to the Singapore government, saying, look, these guys were just following orders, and please, you know, excuse us, I mean, please pardon them on our behalf. Singapore went ahead and hanged them in, 1968. And huge uproar. On the day of the hangings, the Singapore embassy in Jakarta was attacked, ransacked, all kinds of things happened. But Singapore stood firm and hanged those people. But a few years later, the Singapore Prime Minister of the time, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, he did go to the grave site of these Marines and laid flowers and that. So you stand firm on principle at one level, but you show some graciousness at the other. And it came at a cost, because for 5 years, ties were broken with our most important large nation, which is 50 times the size of Singapore. The second instance I want to talk about is when Singapore stood in the Security Council and criticized the US invasion of Grenada in 1983. And now you have to see where Singapore is. The United States is the number one investor in Singapore. Our biggest employers outside the Singapore government is Seagate Technologies that makes semiconductors, Hewlett-Packard, Citibank. I mean, American companies are huge. They are a key lifeline of our of our economy. So Singapore stood by the principle that the rule of law is a shield for small people like us, and that's why. And I'll quote to you the Singapore ambassador's very words to the Security Council, because he says, "To back this or to keep quiet will, in the long run, undermine the moral and legal significance of the principles which my country regards as a shield. This is why we must put adherence to principle above friendship." It was a big decision to take. I mean, to take on the United States by this little minnow in the waters of Southeast Asia is not an easy thing. But they went ahead and did it. Incident number three dates back to 1994. Singapore had a series of vandalism cases across the island in the condominiums. You know, cars were vandalized, paint was put on them at night, and you know, it became a big thing. Some people were caught, and finally one American boy called Michael Fay, who was 18 years old when he did this, he was picked up and sentenced to 6 strokes of the cane, you know, Singapore canes. And it became a big issue in America. No American had ever been caned outside the United States before this. President Clinton demanded that this boy not be caned. The Senate has 50 members. 24 of them wrote a joint appeal for clemency to the President of Singapore. And at that time, Singapore was looking forward to hosting the inaugural summit of the World Trade Organization. You know, as a trade-dependent country, that was a huge thing for us. And the Americans threatened to pull the stops on this. So we'll not let you hold this. Well, Singapore did bend. And how did it bend? The president took 2 strokes out of those 6. Well, that boy got 4 strokes of the cane. And believe me, it caused such a thing. American newspapers, New York Times, Washington Post writing editorials saying that stop investing in this place, pull out this, that, and the other. But 2 years later, I happened to be in the US, and Cabby asked me, where are you from? And I said, from Singapore. He said, oh, you caned that little boy. Good, good, the best thing you did. And, you know, if all the American teenagers here who misbehave could get caned, you would have. And the fourth thing is more recent, that it's quite serious, and that is our position on the South China Sea. Now, we are not a claimant state, but we are a trade-dependent state. We're dependent on open waters, freedom of navigation, freedom of overflight, and so we're one of the most vocal voices in terms of demanding that China follows the rules, the international rules, and it comes at a great cost. We are 77% Chinese. The Chinese are still very aggressive. You know, they go into the communities and spread the word that you know, this guy is not the man his father was, and you know, it's very vexing. They even held our military vehicles coming back from Taiwan. But you either stand up for what you believe in, or you get kicked again and again. And the key lesson from this is, if you can stand up once, can stand up twice, then the world takes note, and then you don't need to do it after that because it becomes a marker of the way. I'll stop with that because ambassadors told me to stop in 10 minutes, and I'm sure a lot of people would have questions for everybody here.
It's a very dangerous word. In the present context, and if I immediately be lapped up as an extremely exciting role model. Now the word used is nationalism. The word parochialism may be taken up. I am, you know, the little that I have read about Japan has made me somewhat skeptical of your recurrent refrain of the parochial Japanese mindset. Of course, it learned from China, because China to Japan has been what Rome and Greece have been to Europe. And what we see, all the examples of, you know, bulk of the examples of contemporary international relations was, you know, largely rooted in the European experience and its extension across the Atlantic on that side. I will just, you know, stop here except to say that what I missed, I would have liked, you know, some reference to these two, you know, examples that we are faced with in a country like India, because if I went out and had to speak again to my Indian students as to the relevance of IR and what I have learned here, I would be at a loss. And hence I would like someone to say, given the nature of intensive and extensive globalization of the contemporary IR, can we understand contemporary IR with its deep historical roots based on European experience? I mean, it would leave out, for example, how does one deal with the two most recent examples of Indian foreign policy or domestic foreign policy. Indo-Canadian relations based on the impact of our diaspora there in the new Trudeau cabinet and the digital president here. And what is likely to be even more explosive, the reports that are now emerging of Margaret President, Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher's help to planning of the Operation Blue Star in India. On the basis of the same example that was given here, Britain's export of arms to Saudi Arabia. And all reports suggest that the justification of the English general who came to advise on Operation Blue Star was precisely because Britain depended upon enormous amount of export. I think all these have to be incorporated in our understanding of international relations to make it relevant for the rest of us. Thank you. If I have said taking a little too long,
We thoroughly enjoyed listening to you. We can't answer your question right now, but we thoroughly enjoyed it. Anybody else? Please.
Es verdad que ya no colleagues.
No, you're young enough.
Having been a junior by several years, so I must say I joined the professor in
retired, sir, madam.
We all are, but not from, of course, consideration of public issues and joining the public discourse. I think each of the presentations, in a sense, yes, I think. They were a world unto themselves, I think. There was some excellent insight into the trends and challenges that the European Union faces. Similarly, the sort of very existential challenge for Japan. And forgive me, I sort of understood the Japanese professor to say that Japan is in fact wanting to, is struggling to come out of its parochialism. And that is the kind of problems they're facing. And of course, Singapore, which is really, in a sense, the role model, I think. Despite its smallness of population and smallness of size, but in terms of its achievement and its respect for institutions, I think it just stands as a case of, and of course it's a kind of moral probity that it would take the kind of stance it has. May I, and I think we'll all probably take away a great deal from each of these brilliant insights, but they're not connecting, because there's not a, but they inform our understanding of the present state of the world. Now, what would link, as the professor is anxious to know, you know, the common challenge, let us say, in the world, the rise of China is one huge thing for each region, but the sort of more, the mega trends that, how are we seeing now with all this in these areas and elsewhere that we know, it kind of, it's a new, you know, uncertainty, as it were, I think. You know, we are entering for the first time a kind of a leaderless world. It's something different. I mean, change we've seen. We've seen a bipolar world, in the Cold War, we've seen a kind of a unipolar triumphalism. But with each such phase, we saw the values of liberalism and free market and democracy gaining more and more universal validity. And what is now happening, it's not just the threat of China waiting in the wings to represent the alternate model, but the free world itself, I think, going through the kind of churning, and then each experience is becoming relevant here. This rise of nationalism, whether it is populist, whether it is authoritarian, or whether it's the Brexit model, what it is, and elsewhere too, right here at home. So I'll just touch on this, and also this kind of impending kind of a veiled threat of, you know, deglobalization, protectionism, and so on, again represents a kind of reversal of, you know, all that we have built up so assiduously, brick by brick, you know, the universal, equitable, free and fair trading system by these regional and intra-regional, you know, partnerships. Some of them are not taking off. I'll just stop here to say that that is the kind of, so with that from each region, one really wonders, I think, facing its own challenges, kind of a churning, I think, and how, I mean, their specific issues lose their significance. It is this broader trend, this big kind of, you know, looking inwards, turning to some very primal instincts as they were, I think, and how, you know, ultimately, what is, I would still tell them, ultimately, it will still have to be the institutions we are familiar with, the rule of law and the strength of the institutions, but I suppose any clarity or considerations would be pretty welcome.
I think what we'll do is we'll have three or four questions and then we'll ask someone to answer them.
My question was, Erickson, you mentioned that in the last elections in Italy, they voted against migration and other parties, the party which came to power, they were against migration and a more of a pro-Italian identity. Do you see it like as an impact of the immigration policies being taken over by Trump in recent times, and Trump has been very harsh on migrants to the United States who have been living in the territory for quite some time. And a recent report was an incident was very, very disturbing. There's a Bangladeshi family, and he was this Bangladeshi person was just in the morning he was standing outside his home and about to take his daughter, a little daughter, to the school, and suddenly the immigration, these officials, like, they came and they just took him, I mean, they just arrested him, and because he was not holding a green card, and he was there, but and the family, and that person, this Bangladeshi national who lived with his family, was was very well known within the community and in the neighborhood, and for his because he was a nice gentleman, I mean, without any prior history of any kind of, like, any antisocial elements to his background. And do you think that this is, I mean, somehow, somewhere, Trump has an impact, and his policies on anti-immigration has an impact on the European Union as well, and therefore this, because as a world community, any nation has to be more of, it has to have, I mean, widen its acceptance. We are a country, we as India, and as an Indian, we have a lot of immigration in our country since times immemorial. So what do you think? I mean, that, and you mentioned that you have to be prepared for the worst. I mean, in terms of international policies, like, because there is a split, I mean, in the European Union, and of course that's quite evident. What you have to see on this? How do you look at this? And so I would like to just mention one thing, like to ask Ravi, that you said that you have, the major share of your, of your fiscal budget is in the,
number one
priorities, and yeah, the security, Now, you say that you, America has never been able to, overpower or been able to, this nation. But anyways, the American army is like, I would like to ask in terms of, like, the American army is certainly more powerful than the army of Singapore.
Well, I think you got me wrong.
If America overpowers a country on to procure this oil, why do you think? Do you think it is just on the basis of your? Yeah. Thank you.
Can we have? I think. Yeah.
I'm a student of international relations at South Asian University, and what this question is for the panel in general. What surprised me was that in a seminar on principle and practice in international relations, what's conspicuously missing is a critical bent thought that all the presenters spoke from a very statist perspective. What was very conspicuously missing was the increasingly growing and valid critical epistemology within the field, the discipline. And while questions were raised on Eurocentric nature, on the very Anglo-American nature of the discipline and of the speakers, the very basis and foundations of those questions were also these Westphalian Anglo-American notions. This is where I find the whole the endeavor has been complicit in sanitizing the discipline of the third world issues and all the issues that concern the global south.
As you said, like if I understood correctly, that you said that future value systems are the product of antithesis of existing system, value system. So my question to Mr. Frederick, where rise of right-wing parties in all over Europe, mostly excessive liberalism has been blamed all over the Europe right now. So we have different models right now. As you said, Brexit model is there right now. In Germany, Christian Democrats and Social Democrats are joining together. And there is Hungarian and Portugal model is there, and there is another French model. What are the suggestions if you have to give these states where their national interest shouldn't contradict with the universal values, and they go along with universal values together? So if you have to suggest these countries or states, what do you suggest? If you have options 1, 2, 3, these countries should follow.
Okay, I want to make a comment on the presentation of Mr. Erickson, but any one of you can answer. Right after the crumbling of the Berlin Wall in November 1989, a very fine mind, Francis Fukuyama, came out with the thesis that there is no alternative to liberal democracy and market economy. 3 years later, a very pessimistic view from the point of view of liberal, and that was The Clash of Civilizations by Sam Huntington, written in 1992. Do you think what we are seeing today in Europe, and certainly in North America and India and Japan and China, is that that Huntington is being replaced?
Thank you very much. I think
it's only fair to give everyone at the panel just a chance to make a short comment.
It's very important to us. All three wings of our armed services trained here, and we are very grateful to India for that. He landed in the evening, and his first engagement was the Singapore lecture, chaired by Deputy Prime Minister Tharman Shanmugaratnam. When the Prime Minister finished it, there's always a token of appreciation that's given. And the DPM Tharman, when giving it to him, it was a pottery. And he said, Prime Minister Modi, this is made by our most distinguished Muslim artist. Second day. Now, I'm interpreting here, okay? I'm not speaking with the Singapore government. Maybe it was a series of happy accidents. But next day at lunch, there was a luncheon speech by the Prime Minister, where he listed out all the contributions of Muslim businessmen to Singapore. Any Indian Muslim businessman to Singapore. Now, I'm not suggesting anything here, but these things happen. Now, it's for you to draw your own conclusions. When you make these kind of points to the world, I mean, the world up and south and north and our own people and everywhere else listen. So it's something fundamental to our existence that we will not tolerate. There'll never be a Charlie Hebdo in Singapore. And it's that firmness of conviction and the determination to go through with it that hopefully helps us stay safe. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you for all the comments and questions. Two things that always happens when I'm here in India to speak is that, firstly, when I get invited to speak about Europe, I get accused of being Eurocentric. To which I say, well, invite me to speak about something else then. The other thing which always happens is that people want me to deliver theories, grand theories about the world, which I can't. I'm a humble Swede, prone to more practical thinking than big theories. Nor am I a salvationist with the capacity to come up with a program for how to save the world. So I'm afraid I'm going to disappoint you what I'm going to say here now. So firstly, on questions regarding sort of anti-immigration sentiments in Europe. I mean, I think it's obvious that there has been a growth in anti-immigration sentiments in Europe over the past couple of years. I don't think they are related to Trump. I think they are far more related to developments in Europe, both regarding the volumes of refugees that came, the incapacity of governments to respond to the problems that comes when you have a huge influx of refugees, and to the stream of terrorist attacks that has happened across Europe, Stockholm, London, Paris, Brussels, Berlin, which of course prompts people to be fearful of perhaps migrants generally, but specifically migrants from Muslim countries. So I think we can sort of say that this is perfectly obvious. Then we need to go to the specifics of countries to understand why voting patterns may have been, as we have seen pretty recently. So take a country like Italy. So people there are not just protesting against migration, far from it. It's the two parties, the post-fascist party and the fascist party, they are the ones that represent an idea about sort of Italian purity and sort of a nativist interpretation of Italy, and the reading of history is basically how all things start to go badly when migration start to be a bigger thing in the country. That's not really the thing with Movement 5 Stella, which draws support from different type of people, but what they all have in common is that they are different from the existing establishment. If there's one thing which is a common philosophy amongst these voters, it is that the current elite is corrupt. Unfortunately, that is not an untrue statement. But then there's one particular dimension which regards immigration, which have affected Italy more than any other countries, which of course has to do with its location in the Mediterranean Sea, and that a lot of the refugees have come on these boats and ended up in Italy. And how has the government dealt with that situation? Well, they haven't dealt with it. They have offered non-solutions to problems that people find when there are huge volumes of refugees that come and they don't have any other place to go. They've offered the solution that there should be a European-wide mechanism to allocate these refugees to other countries in Europe. And most other countries have said that they are either not interested in it or that they're already taking big volumes of migrants that come through different routes into Europe. So it's a non-solution. And I think it's partly that which has also influenced why 12% of Germans voted for Alternative for Deutschland in the last election in September. And we've seen the opinion polls showing that this party now has grown even more. It's in the polls the second biggest party in Germany right now. And when you look at opinions and surveys around openness attitudes towards migrants, it's not that Germans generally have become xenophobic. Far from it. I mean, most parts of Europe and most part of the population remains very, very open. It's a country that prides itself on having what they call a willkommen Kultur, a welcoming culture. But they have been furious that the incapacity of Berlin to actually deal with issues, finding not just shelter, but accommodation for people, finding places at schools, finding places at kindergartens, finding staff that's going to work in the healthcare centers and the hospitals that need to take care of them, finding a way for these people to integrate, to get a job. All these problems have prompted a bigger part of Germany to feel that we want to be open, but now you present us with an offer which simply doesn't hang together. We want to be even more open, but we don't have any solution for how we're going to change our society to make it possible to get sort of these millions of newcomers to find their way in society. I can see that in many other countries in Europe as well, that the support for being an open country, to have openness to labor migration, remains very, very strong at the same time as they are insistent on reducing the number of refugees that come. My point here is basically that there hasn't been a big shift in the sense that Europe is becoming xenophobic. Luckily, it isn't as bad as that. It's more sort of practical issues. It's issues related to some forms of migration, especially from Muslim countries, and it is what I talked about initially, the fact that many of these European societies have changed. These are societies, many of them, they are not historically accustomed to being multicultural societies. These are pretty monologue type of countries in the sense that they haven't been used to migration, and suddenly they have come to a point where they've seen the societies have shifted, and now they want to figure out what is it actually that binds us together, all those peoples that live within these borders. What is the identity which makes us Germans or French or Swedes or what have you? And I think this is the challenge they are looking at right now, and as a consequence of that, we see this erosion about the support for the European Union, the postmodern construct in the sense that people now want to think that borders actually have a significance, that sort of there's something with them that actually matter. And that's where we are right now. In that sense, I don't think there's in Europe a big sort of clash between Fukuyama and Huntington. I actually reread Fukuyama not that long ago for a book that I'm working on, and I think there's still sort of a good case you can make for most of his thesis, not his all parts of his thesis, but most of his thesis, which is that the sort of nationalism that we have seen grow in different parts of the world, the sort of challenges to a transatlantic, unipolar, American-led world order from especially the rising power like China, none of that has led to a point where people believe that there is ideologically a rival idea out there which is much better than the idea of democracy, rule of law, and in a broad sense, an open market-based economy. I don't think there's anyone out there sort of with an idea representing something which is so much better that they go to get a lot of people and countries to support it. I just don't see that. I think there is some optimistic and positive lessons to draw from that sort of even if we are in different parts of the world going to choose different paths going forward, I think there is a pretty strong and solid support for this idea, and we can discuss exactly what roots it has, which is based on the notion of democracy combined with civil liberties, with rule of law, and market-based exchange between countries. I think what has happened, which perhaps relates more to your comment, is that many of the international institutions we have in order to deal with those issues, they aren't equipped to sort of to deal with the modern type of world we have today. They are, many of them, constructs of a Eurocentric world, which is basically they were born as a consequence of world wars in Europe and the necessity to try to find ways for countries to build peace, stability, and prosperity, and tying countries much closer to each other. That's sort of starting the OECD, starting not just the EU, starting sort of the GATT agreements, etc. With time, that has changed, and we have seen for a long time now that there isn't any type of monopoly which exists for America and Europe in order to run these institutions or control their development. But what has existed in these institutions is sort of a belief that whatever happens, and despite the difficulties that we're going to find along the way, we are going to move towards a greater degree of openness, a greater degree of understanding that we have sort of common problems that needs common solutions. And I think many of these institutions have proven themselves to be utterly useless in order to actually do that. So we talk about sort of the collapse of the World Trade Order now. I mean, no one talks about the World Trade Organization these days and trying to re-engineer a role for it in global trade. Well, I mean, when I started to work on trade policy in the early 1990s, it was the case already then. We had then sort of getting close to finalizing what was called the Uruguay round, which had proven to be an extraordinarily difficult round to do, which for a long time seemed to be going nowhere and seemed to be faced with so much problems that sort of many countries thought it's probably best just to pack up and do something else. And then because a couple of things that happened, which changed the political incentives of different countries to do different things, came around in the form of the Soviet Union. A big thing at that point, which lended enormous political impetus to a lot of governments around the world to try to finish things and try to build something up. We started not in the WTO meeting in Singapore in 1997, but in 1999, first in Seattle, the idea of having a millennium round on trade policy, that didn't happen. So we went to Doha after 9/11 in order to set up a new round there. But sort of that was a round which was born in the ashes of the Twin Towers, and the political glue that forced countries to come together was this notion that sort of 9/11 happened. We needed a response. The response would show greater international unity. But ultimately, what was proven was that no one knew how you actually can do that, given all the different interests and different opinions that existed between the countries that were supposed to come to an agreement with the ORI. So it didn't fly, it didn't go nowhere. So I think it's absolutely correct that if we want international institutions to be part and more powerful in the future, we have to re-engineer them pretty fundamentally. We have to probably destroy many of the institutions that exist right now and begin to build new ones. And as part of that, I'm pretty sure that many of the countries that now belong to some of these institutions, they can't be in the future simply because they don't believe in what has to be substantive ideas that are in these institutions.
Thank you very much, Frederick. I see that all the speakers have left your question to me. And I know who's going to answer it, actually. I've got another retired professor here who is more than capable of answering your question, but I have a feeling that it'll take too long for the mic to reach him. So let me have a go at it. Now, if you wanted coherence, we should have had one speaker for 80 minutes instead of four speakers for 15 minutes each. And that would have very adequately solved your problem. But you see, unfortunately, we had no choice in the matter. So we were asked to come and we've done our best. Now, the question you pose is really quite interesting because none of the great IR experts or political thinkers, to my knowledge, have been able to answer your question. This gentleman would have been able to, but I'm not going to give him the floor. So the best brains in the world have had no answer. Now, as Mr. Erickson said, you know, institutions are in serious decline at the moment. Now, who frankly cares about what is discussed at even the summit conferences of SCO, ASEAN, OAU? Have you any idea what the last OAU summit decided, if anything? And the same goes for SARC, for example. I mean, when did we last hear about SARC? So, you know, we've got a situation where all the institutions in the world are in serious trouble. And as Mr. Erickson said, that they may have to be remade. Meanwhile, there have been other proposals put forward. Fukuyama and Huntington certainly did not have any answers to the questions that that we ask ourselves. There have been proposals like the League of Democracies. Now, that got absolutely nowhere. It's an American-sponsored idea. And the idea being that democracies don't fight each other, etc. It was a fallacy right from the beginning. So, you know, what you've got at the moment is, since the World War II, probably, the most unstable world situation. You've got a situation where the then unipolar world has changed, and you haven't yet arrived at a situation where there is a multipolar world. So you've got neither a North Pole nor a South Pole to look at. The world actually is in very, very serious flux. You've got the meteoric rise of a nation country, the first that has happened probably in history, which is capable of, I'm leaving Japan out because it was not seeking to confront the rest of the world. This country might be seeking to at least engage the rest of the world in very serious competition. Now, this country is likely to challenge the world's biggest economy, and later on perhaps the world's biggest military as well. When it becomes the world's biggest economy, which it will do, it will not be the world's biggest military. The biggest world's biggest military will continue to be what it is today, which is the United States. And so you'll have a situation where the biggest economy and the biggest military are in two separate countries and two separate hands. Now, that's not likely to be a very easy situation to manage. And adding a further complexity to that situation, the world's biggest military power will be in debt to the world's biggest economy, which is going to be an extremely untenable situation. But even faster than the rise of China, the meteoric rise of China, is the rise of technology, and the rise of technology and artificial intelligence. So the whole world now can be in your palm. I mean, you don't have to go anywhere. Your office is right there in your phone. So this is an unimaginable change which has taken place in the last 10 years. So never in the history of human beings has there been this rapid change of the way of life, the way we interact with each other. Now, our politicians, to say nothing of social media, which is a different and unmanaged power in its own respect. Now, our politicians and military people, when I say our, I mean the whole world, are fighting the battles of yesterday. You don't really think the competition of tomorrow is going to be like the competition of, let us say, the past 10 years? Of course not. And you've got the United States and Europe now complaining about interference in their elections, but it's not human interference. It's a technology. technological interference from heaven knows where and from who knows who. So, you know, this is a completely different type of competition we're going to enter into. In the same way, IR is not the same also. You're speaking of IR as if it's frozen in time. But IR is going to change very, very considerably. We're going to have to deal with completely different types of interstate and interperson relationships in future. So we've got to think laterally. I know that's a foolish expression, but we've got to think in a completely new way. And I'd like to just conclude by saying that we've been speaking about foreign policy from time to time, probably the greatest foreign minister of the United Kingdom is a person called Ernest Bevin. Now, very few will remember because very few of you were born before the Second World War. But Ernest Bevin was asked what his foreign policy was. He said, "My foreign policy is to buy a ticket in Victoria Station and go where I damn well like." Except he didn't say damned, he said something rather stronger. So that perhaps at the end of the day is any country's best foreign policy. Thank you very much indeed for your patience. Thank you very much.